Okay, let's call this meeting of the Special Committee on Certificate of Need to order. I apologize for being late. I was presenting a bill to a Senate committee. Thank you for your indulgence in letting me be late. Okay. Senator Williams, you're up with a substitute to Senate Bill 433, and we are working off LC 332591S. Is that it?
Madam Chairwoman, if I could bring up Josh Belfani, who's the governor's attorney, who's helped me with the substitute, and
That's fine.
I really appreciate the members of the committee and your willingness to hear this bill today. The genesis of the original bill comes as a result of my efforts to try to bring in Cancer Treatment Centers of America. That's, in my opinion, a very fine company that really focuses on the patient in regards to cancer treatment centers, cancer treatment. My father died of cancer, as many of, you know, almost everybody has a relative that has had cancer or will have cancer. But my reason for coming to the General Assembly in the first place, because I ran a trucking company, and just over-regulation frustrated me to no end, and I said, well, I'm going to run for the General Assembly, see if I can do something about some of this. And so, as you see the CON process, you begin to wonder, how did this thing become so complex and in many cases so wrong? But nevertheless, here was a company that wanted to come to Georgia that to do good work and frankly could not come. And there was no way for them to get a CON. They tried that on a number of occasions and were told no. And so I tried to create a way for them to get a CON by making a place that simply identified their type of facility, which is not needs-based like other hospitals. It's based on the fact that most of their patients would be coming from out of state. So we did that, and we further developed the bill to try to build consensus. The things we have done up to this point as it relates to CTCA are these. We've upped the penalties if they do not meet the 65% rule to $1 million, $2 million, $3 million, and $4 million on the fourth year. So that's fairly substantial, and I think they, you know, if you have to pay out $4 million, you're going to meet your numbers. And the fact that they're doing this in other states, they feel secure that this is their model and they will do it. The other thing is we've closed the door once they apply, where we have a sunset, so that no one else can apply, which was a concern of some, and we've limited them to one facility. That was a concern of others. So we've done all the things, and we require them to do 3% Medicaid and indigent, I guess, too. So those are, in my opinion, CTCA, and in my efforts, have been just to bend over backwards to the point that you still have to let them apply for a CON. But we're doing all these things that you've asked us to do to make you more comfortable with them being here. And, you know, everywhere they've been, they've had they've been very active in communities. The Chamber of Commerce in those states and cities where they're located have just welcomed them with open arms, in fact, given them the money to come. We're not offering any tax breaks. They're going to be a for-profit company paying taxes. They're not asking for economic development money. They just want to come to Georgia and open up and hang out their shingle and provide what I think is excellent service to Georgians and to folks throughout the Southeast. Now, you know, as you all know, getting a bill passed through both houses is a very difficult job. And actually getting this bill out of the Senate when there were about 90 lobbyists hired to keep it from happening, and frankly, the Chamber of Commerce was not for it. I still don't understand that position, but nevertheless. Well, we got the bill out, and I realized that to get it out of the House, we needed a more comprehensive bill. Many of you sitting on this committee, as well as the governor's office, as well as Don Balfour in the Senate, and others have tried to build a compromise. And frankly, stand alone, you trying to bring parties together, me trying to bring parties together, it just will not work. If it had, we'd already have a CON bill out. But everybody agrees, even the opponents agree, that something needs to be done, and they even formed a commission to come up with the solutions. And many people voted unanimously on a number of those solutions. And so my effort here has been to say, who has offered bills? Who knows a lot about these subject matter? Austin has, Representative Scott has worked on this for a long time. Representative Chanel has introduced a bill and worked on this for a long time. The chairwoman has worked on this for a long time and introduced legislation. The governor has proposed his own legislation after countless hours of CON work. Don Balfour, on the Senate side, had introduced legislation. So my effort was to bring all those folks in one room and say, without all the attorneys and without all of the doctors and without all of the surgeons and without all of the hospital administrators and without all their lobbyists, let's see if we can't determine what a good CON bill would look like. And in about 3 hours, we had one. And that's what we're here today to present. And I think you'll find that almost everybody that is a stakeholder likes the bill. They may not be totally happy, and you know this, you know that when you got a bill that everybody's happy with, it's not a good bill. If you've got one that everybody's a little dissatisfied with, you're probably on target. And I think we've done that. We had, and as you know, as your own members are, some are a little bit on the doctor side and some are a little bit on the hospital side, and we've got a good balance. And I asked the Ledge Council to sit in to help us draft the bill. And Josh Belafonte, who probably knows the issue as well as anybody and has worked tirelessly to try to get the governor a bill out. So I asked him to sit in to help us draft the bill, to go over things we did agree on, to go over the things that were somewhat agreed upon, and build a bill on that. And some things we just could not approach because it was too difficult. But, Madam Chairwoman, if you'll allow me to have Josh introduce our compromise.
That would be fine. Thank you, Senator.
Good to see everybody again.
Welcome back. It's been a long time.
It has. Just so we're all working off of LC 332591S. Is that correct? Okay. And does everyone have one of these kind of walkthrough sheets? You know, I'm happy to go ahead, unless Chairman Scott, I know you reviewed this as well, if you want to walk through it or.
Madam Chair, if it's okay with the committee, Josh knows the technicals probably better than any individual. And I think the thing I would reiterate with what Senator Williams said is it's been almost 4 years since the House and the Senate, I believe, unanimously passed the legislation that created the Certificate of Need Commission. That commission met for a long time, had a lot of people that were much more knowledgeable about health care, certainly than I am. We had hospital administrators on it. We had the president of the Medical College of Georgia was on it. We had a physician on it. We had the commissioner of DCH on it. And this has been a four-year process on this legislation. And I guess the thing I would ask the committee to keep in mind as we move forward is not everybody is going to like everything in this bill, or I should say nobody is going to like everything in this bill. I hope that, you know, what objections you have we can discuss and maybe work through them. And I would say to you this question, you know, if not this, what? And if not now, when? And I certainly think this is an issue that we all need to put to rest. I think our hospitals and our physicians and their patients need this issue put to rest so that we can start working on other health care related issues. Thank you.
Do And I'll just start moving down. And the way this is broken out is in a format the committee is very familiar with, based on the CON Commission recommendations. The number underneath the recommendation is the vote count. The first is moving the licensing functions of the Department of Office and Regulatory Services from DHR to DCH. That is a bulk of the bill, as you can see, just based on where it is in location. It's pages 56 through 73. That way, the same facility that approves your CON application will also approve your license. Amend the licensure statute to permit licensure standards on a clinical service level. That is in the bill as well. The thought there is, as opposed to being licensed as, say, a hospital can have several licenses, one for open heart surgery, one for diagnostic cardiac cath, one for orthopedic surgery, and so on. The next, the 1.2, allows the Department of Community Health to place a moratoria on new and emerging services for a time not to exceed 6 months, which may be renewed for an additional 3 months. The thought is here, if there's some new technology coming in to Georgia that the department has not seen in the past, this will allow the department, if it deems necessary, to put a hold on approving CON applications so they can study the new technology and come up with some need criteria to do so. And I'll try to get through as well. Each of the 1.0, 1.1, and 1.2 were in the bill this house, or excuse me, this committee voted out last year. 1.3 makes the Health Strategies Council advisory in nature. That is current law. This cleans it up and makes it clear that the Health Strategies Council remains advisory. It does not it is not a necessary route that the department has to go on approval of rules. The Health Strategies Council will be decreased if this bill passes from 15 members to 13. That is from the bill last year as well. And one of the additions that you'll find in this bill that this House passed out is making sure that the physicians on the board, or excuse me, on the Health Strategies Council are actually in the active practice of medicine. That was one of the pieces of reform that this committee decided last year. The Commission recommended that the Health Strategies Council meet bi-monthly. This committee last year did not endorse that recommendation, and the reason is if they're advisory, then the committee, the Health Strategies Council itself, can determine how often it should meet. And as it's new for it to be advisory, it would be best for them to have that opportunity. So you will not find that recommendation in this bill, just as it was not in House Bill 568 last year. The Commission recommended that the governor can remove a member of the Health Strategies Council for any reason whatsoever. This committee changed that and said the governor should not remove someone unless they have cause. That piece from the committee remains in the bill. The governor will not remove any member of the Health Strategies Council without cause. The Commission also recommended that there be an increase in statutory fine for failure to obtain a certificate of need based on $5,000 per day for the first month, $1,000 a day for the second month, and $25,000 a day for subsequent months. That is in the bill. That was also something that passed out of this committee last year. The same is for the next 1.8. It allows DCH to levy fines of $500 a day for the first month, $1,000 a day for subsequent months, and then possibly revoke a CON for failure to provide data. As this committee will recall, last year we spent a fair amount of time talking about data. Hospitals, ambulatory surgery centers, diagnostic treatment, rehabilitation centers all will need to provide data to the department based on what's going on at the facility, some of the financial information, and failure to do that would warrant these penalties before you. The department will also be allowed to issue conditional CONs and revoke them when conditions are not met. The most obvious area where this is that the department can issue a CON, let's say, to a hospital on the condition that they take Medicaid patients and treat up to 3% charity and indigent care. That's the current rule. And if that is not fulfilled, the department will have the authority to revoke that CON. That too passed this committee last year. And I'll just say these first several, in almost all the bills that were introduced last year on CON, all of these were included in those bills. The department will have the authority to revoke parts of a CON as opposed to the whole CON. That's kind of dovetailing on the last point as well. I can go on to 2.0 unless folks have questions. Okay. 2.0 is to batch applications by clinical health service. This is, as y'all will recall, last year we talked about when, let's say, two hospitals in an area want to provide open heart surgery. Under current law, whoever submits the application first has an advantage because if, as the process moves along, you know, whoever goes first is ahead in the process as the department reviews it and so on and so forth. Well, if that hospital gets it in before the other competing hospital, it will satisfy any need for open heart surgery. So the commission recommended, rather than having it on a first-come, first-served basis, you batch the applications by a clinical health service. So all the open heart applications come in at one time, and there's no advantage for filing before another. The department, and this is another one, but just while I'm speaking about it, the department will review these batched applications at least twice a year. They may review them more, but the minimum is twice a year. That was part of House Bill 568 as well, and a unanimous recommendation. Increasing the review time for the department to 120 days to allow the department to develop rules and regulations, and then also allow the department to come up with rules and regulations setting the time periods during this batching process. That's what recommendation 2.1 speaks to. That was a unanimous recommendation. It was in all the bills and is included in the House sub that you see before you. Providing opposition meetings during the review cycle was recommendation 2.2. It was unanimous. That is in this legislation. It was in House Bill 568, and it was imported from Chairman Chanel's bill, I believe, when we took 568 last year. So a lot of this is coming from his bill. The Health Planning Review Board model is the current model by which parties appeal the grant or denial of a CON application. And the commission recommended that the Health Planning Review Board is cumbersome, it takes a while, and better to do it like we treat most other areas of administrative law, put it under the Administrative Procedures Act. There's a fair amount going on in terms of the procedural review process. What I can tell the committee is last year, this committee more or less took the provisions from Chairman Chanel's bill about having an independent hearing officer who is not selected by the commissioner to review the department's decision on whether to grant a CON or to deny a CON. That independent hearing officer does not defer to the commissioner whatsoever. It's what's called a de novo review. They don't give them any presumption. That hearing officer is now, it's called the CON appeal panel. This committee may remember this from last year. And that is what is in the statute now. It is almost a wholesale adoption from that bill. Requiring appellants to contribute to a hearing funds pool at the time of requesting the initial administrative appeal. What that means is, let's say the department has made a decision, and then a party wants to appeal that decision. Whichever party appeals the decision to this hearing officer will have to front the costs of that appeal, not the cost of the other party, not their attorney's fees. We're not talking about that yet. But they would have to pay basically the time of the hearing officer and the rate of the hearing officer to do the review. And the hearing panel will come up with the fees for that. Now, the way the bill is drafted, if the party who appeals wins, meaning the hearing officer reverses the department's decision, that party is refunded that money. And I'll just go through some of how the process works in this bill, because it comes up under the next recommendation on 2.5. So if you've got an applicant that comes in, they want to open up a new hospital, the department has an initial decision to make. And the other side is invited and, in fact, required to submit opposition to the department if they oppose the opening of a new hospital. So the department can review the evidence submitted by the applicant, and so the department can review the evidence submitted by the opponent. Once the department makes a decision, let's say they approve the application for a new hospital, the opposing hospital can then go to the hearing officer, who will review the appeal de novo, not deferring to the department. And in that appeal to a hearing officer, a party can bring in new evidence that the department did not consider. The only caveat is that new evidence could not have been reasonably available to the department. Under current law, there's no new evidence permitted. So this is a little more flexible, but it prevents a situation where someone was holding back the really good study and then wants to put it on the opponent in the appeal panel. Let's say the hearing officer affirms the department, so the application for the hospital is approved. There is another line of appeal, and that would be to the commissioner of the department. The commissioner's discretion to overturn the decision of a hearing officer is very limited. It has to be based on a mistake in law, and she cannot overturn, I believe, a finding of fact. So if the fact question is, you know, is there need of the hearing officer, except in very, very limited circumstances. If the commissioner approves the decision of the hearing officer, which approved the decision of the department, then the party who appealed to the commissioner will be responsible for the attorney's fees and cost of the party that had to respond to that appeal, starting at the time of the hearing officer's decision. So it's basically three strikes, and then they'll pay attorney's fees and cost starting at the time of the appeal to the commissioner. If at any point there is a different decision, so the hearing officer disagrees with the department or the commissioner disagrees with the hearing officer, that attorney's fees provision doesn't apply. It is really if there's been a consistent upholding of the department's decision, then there is attorney's fees and costs. And then any party that wants to appeal the decision of the commissioner to the superior court will also face attorney's fees and costs of the other party for the court action if the party responding to the appeal, so the party that didn't want to be in superior court to begin with, is victorious by final order, meaning after all the appeals processes are done, then that party will be entitled to reasonable attorney's fees and costs from the time that it goes to the superior court. There is one caveat to the attorney's fees provision, and it is that there are some arguments that a party cannot raise at the administrative appeal. For instance, a party can't challenge the constitutionality of a rule, for example, at the administrative appeal. So if a party brings a new argument that they could not have brought either to the department, to the hearing officer, or to the commissioner, that portion of the attorney's fees are not subject to the attorney's fees provision. What that means is that attorneys are going to have to, when they're doing their timesheets, you know, put, you know, which provision, you know, they were working on at that time. I've had to do that. It's not fun. But if, you know, the theory is if you're going to be getting attorney's fees, it shouldn't be a bar to arguments that couldn't be raised. That's kind of takes you through 2.5 as well. The commission also recommended in recommendation 2.6 to have definitive timelines on the court so that a case doesn't sit pending in a superior court docket for months, sometimes a year. That was one of the big complaints that the commission heard, is that there'll be an application, it'll go about a year through the administrative process, then it'll sit in a superior court for a year, sometimes more, and a decision won't be made. Under the bill before you, if the court doesn't act within 90 days, the decision of the department is deemed affirmed. And so there are dead set timelines that move on. This committee passed a similar, I think it may have been with a 90-day or maybe a 60-day in House Bill 568. This extends it to 90. Recommendation 3.0, authorizing the department to require notification of items exempt from review for certain exemptions. Specifically, the commission recommends that once so empowered, the department require advance notification and approval for exemptions related to exempt ambulatory surgery centers, if the exemption remains, and equipment purchased below a threshold. This is in the bill. This has been adopted in two ways. One, any current ambulatory surgery center or imaging center will need to report to the department where they are, what their ownership structure is, and what they do. They'll need to do that by December 30th of this year. For most of the ambulatory surgery centers out there, it's the belief that they have an LNR, the letter of non-reviewability, and so the department knows who they are, what they're doing, and so on. This tries to catch those that may not have submitted a letter of non-reviewability to the department, and so we'll know exactly who's out there and at what time. The going forward, any ambulatory surgery center, any time a office or a hospital attempts to use the threshold on imaging, as you all recall, there's currently about $863,000. If you spend under that on machinery or equipment or imaging machines, there's no CON requirement. Anything over that, you need to go through a CON. Whenever that exemption, whenever someone tries to avail themselves to that exemption going forward, they need to notify the department that they're doing it, and there is a process in place so that folks opposing that have time to do so. Under current law, if someone has an exemption, let's take an ambulatory surgery center. You can have an ambulatory surgery center apply, the department approves a letter of non-reviewability, they've been open for a month, and all of a sudden they get slapped with a lawsuit that they didn't submit proper paperwork or whatnot. And I'm not commenting on the validity of the lawsuits, but this does happen. And occasionally the department will put a cease and desist order in on the ambulatory surgery center based on either information that was inaccurate or information that you know, upon further review indicates they really were not exempt for whatever reason. This tries to prevent kind of the surprise method, and both sides, I think, will benefit from this, and say that when a party applies for an exemption, so let's just take the ambulatory surgery center, they need to notify the department. The department will notify by posting it on a website or just public notice, and opposition will have time to submit, you know, letters of opposition, documents if need be, and the department will rule. Once the department rules, you're brought into an administrative hearing. If there is an appeal, it goes to an administrative law judge, like many other regulatory cases right now. And then if that decision's appealed, you've got the same framework for going to the Superior Court we talked about for the CON applicants. Set deadlines, attorney's fees, for the prevailing party, and so on. So that's adopting that recommendation. 3.1 recommended raising the capital expenditure threshold from the current $1.495 million to $1.75 million and maintain the provision relating to an annual adjustment of this dollar amount. The group, as it says, partly adopted that, and this is the capital expenditure threshold that mostly applies to hospitals. I believe last year 568 had a capital expenditure threshold for hospitals at $5 million. The thought was if a hospital wants to spend $5 million, then have at it. It's their decision, and they can do that. During the committee process, and then through the summer, fall, winter, some of the hospital groups have expressed that they would like to keep the cap. So what we did is raise it to $2.5 million and maintained that it will be indexed to the composite construction index, not the consumer price index. That's current law will do that. 3.2 is a similar threshold issue. This is for equipment and imaging, and this bill treats equipment the same across the board except for in one area on imaging, and I'll just talk about how imaging came to be now. Over the summer, fall, and through about early February, the governor's office had been engaged, as many of y'all know, in trying to get a CON compromise bill. On some issues, we actually had consensus. Imaging is one of them. And so the current imaging proposal is, instead of the $823,000 cap, it will be $1 million. That $1 million applies only to the equipment and equipment-related materials, so the software to run the equipment, service agreements, things that are based on the equipment itself, not build-out costs. Because in current law, if I'm a physician and I want to build or bring in an MRI machine and I've got to change my physical plant to do so, the amount of cost it takes me to knock out some walls is included in the threshold. So this raises it to $1 million. It's equipment only. And unlike in the status quo where it's tied to the consumer or composite construction index, it will be tied to the consumer price index. And that inflation tacking will begin in 2010. The only entities that can take advantage of this exemption for imaging beyond your basic imaging, your x-rays, fluoroscopes, ultrasounds, are physicians' offices that use the imaging for their own patients and hospitals. This is a change from what the committee recommended last time. But that is where an area where we had consensus from several of the parties, and that is why you'll see it in the bill as it stands. 3.3, this is probably the most popular CON recommendation, which is to make sure that parking decks, medical office buildings, physical plant is not included in a capital expenditure threshold. That has been adopted, and that will be exempt from CON review. 3.4 deals with location. The commission recommended to add a statutory exemption for relocation of an existing facility within a limited distance. And the committee may recall we probably spent at least an hour debating what is a limited distance, what is a reasonable distance last time. What you'll see in the bill before you is that nursing homes can relocate anywhere in the county that they currently operate without having to go through the CON process. In rural counties, any facility, hospitals, ambulatory surgery centers, imaging centers, can relocate anywhere in the county. In urban counties, all facilities, with the exception of nursing homes because they can go anywhere, can relocate within 3 miles of an existing facility. And we actually had consensus on this during those negotiations that went on and discussions this summer and winter. Now we're getting into some of the review criteria. That's 4.0. And as the committee will recall, the review criteria, those broad guidance set out in... Sure.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just very quickly, Josh, you mind sharing as you go through this, and I know you're trying to, where you've got consensus and where you've got agreement between the two parties, and telling us specifically where you don't.
Okay.
And but my real question is, I know that DCH during this interim time has taken upon themselves to go ahead with some of the things that we talked about. Are those specifically the nursing home part of it? And also, I believe, the general surgery being single specialty, blah, blah, blah. Is that in here so that I know there's a court case involving them where whether they could do that or not is being challenged? Is that in here to where, however that turns out, at least we're taking care of it now?
There is a court case on the general surgery provision, and I'll... If it's all right with you, I'll speak to that when we get to the ambulatory surgery. On the nursing home, what the rule change did is you've got general need criteria, which is typically broader and easier to meet, and there's often service-specific need criteria. So nursing homes have their own need criteria separate and apart from the general need criteria. You've got the same thing for open heart and others. What the rule said for nursing homes is if they are seeking to relocate within the county, they only need to satisfy the general need criteria, not the more stringent service-specific need criteria. What this says is if they're seeking to relocate anywhere within the county, there's no need criteria they have to satisfy. That's just exempt from CON review.
Okay.
And should this bill pass, it would supersede any of the decisions made by the department?
Should this bill pass, it will certainly moot a lawsuit challenging the authority of the department to define single specialty.
We have one more question. Representative Peek.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Josh, we debated at length last time about rural versus urban. Could you define that again just real quick?
Rural are those counties that are 35,000 or less.
Which is consistent with what we had discussed last year during the discussion.
Okay. That's right.
Just want to make sure. Okay.
If I might add, in terms of what's in this bill, we didn't put anything in the bill except that Representative Scott, Cooper, Chanel, Don Balfour, myself, and the majority leader on the House side were in agreement. If we couldn't get agreement, we didn't put it in this bill.
And I have to say that finding Representative Chanel, that the two of us could agree, was a major move and decision on this. So, and the fact that we did it, like the Senator said, in 3 hours, was unusual and remarkable, but it showed how carefully we had looked at this issue. Okay.
And Representative Carter, if I could just address one more point when you asked about where there was consensus. What will be, I can sit here and tell you where at the time we had consensus. My guess is that some will say, yes, we agreed to that only when everything else was looking different. So there's very limited times where I'll be able to do that. And just because there was consensus at that time by no means means there will be consensus now. But it did have consensus of all the people in that room. And a lot of it was based on what, you know, we had learned as this issue remained active throughout the year. But I'll do my best to try to highlight that when I can. We were at 4.0, which is adding a review criteria regarding quality of care. And this addresses, as I was saying, those broad statutory directions to the department. When they come up with rules to define need, these are the things they consider. This committee last year passed or adopted this recommendation. So one of the things the department will consider as it does a CON review is, does the provider have a history of quality of care? If you've got a facility that's really lacking in various areas for quality of care, the department may use that as a means to deny a CON application. And it conversely can work in favor of a facility with a good history. The next would be to provide favorable consideration to projects and applicants where the applicant agrees to provide an underrepresented service in addition to the service for which the application was made. So let's say a hospital comes and says, we want to do open heart surgery, and if we can do that, then we'll also do some underrepresented service, whatever that could be, and I'll defer to the department for examples on that. That was a unanimous recommendation. It was in the bills, all of them, I think, and it's in this bill. The next is a recommendation that the department's health planning functions be adequately staffed and supplied with the appropriate resources. You will not find language like that in the bill simply because and this committee did not put language like that in the bill last year because it just begs the question of what does it mean and what does it do. 4.3 recommends that the department adopt and follow proactive and prospective approach to need methodologies and emerging technologies by addressing such factors in its annual report. That was in all the bills. It's adopted here. Essentially, when the department gives an annual report to the legislature, there will be a section talking about what they see coming on the horizon in terms of emerging technologies and what the General Assembly can expect to see. That will be added as well. Next, we're getting into some of the areas where there was not unanimous consensus among the CON Commission members. I'm going to join, if it's all right with the committee, 5.0, 5.1, and 5.3. They all deal with short-stay hospital beds and when can a hospital add more beds without the permission of the state. And the question was really asked three different ways by the CON Commission. What you find in the bill before you is an adoption of the majority recommendation, which is 5.2. Under current law, if a hospital has utilization of 85% in a given 2 years, then it can expand and add more beds by either 10 more beds or 10%, whichever is greater. All this does is change 85 to 75. It's giving the hospitals a little more flexibility to add the beds. What the bill that passed out of this committee last session, in fact, made this a wholesale exemption, and whenever a hospital wanted to add short stay beds, they could do so. This adopts the majority recommendation on that issue. 6.0, this is dealing with diagnostic cardiac catheterization. The commission recommended, a majority of the commission recommended on a 4 in favor, 1 opposed, 5 abstained vote to deregulate diagnostic cardiac catheterization and require therapeutic catheterizations to be performed only by providers approved to offer open heart surgery. What the bill before you does is essentially what the bill did last year that this committee approved, which is it deregulates diagnostic cardiac catheterization in a hospital setting. So there will not be freestanding ambulatory surgery centers without going through a CON doing diagnostic cardiac caths. It also allows, there are 10 hospitals that have participated in the Seaport study, and these are hospitals that are now doing therapeutic cardiac catheterizations. It says for those hospitals that are taking part in this study, they can maintain that ability to do the therapeutic catheterizations as they have been now since, I believe, 2005. I think that's correct. The next two recommendations were unanimous, which was maintain the existing CON regulation on open heart surgery and on pediatric cardiac catheterization and open heart surgery. Pediatric open heart surgery, those have been adopted. We'll still need a CON for that. 7.0, the commission, and I failed to put the vote on this one, and I believe it was a majority vote, and I'll be able to check if there's a break. I've got the report down here with me. The commission recommended to deregulate level 1 perinatal services and continue the regulation of level 2 and neonatal intensive care. This is basically the basic birthing services. Last year, the committee recommended to deregulate level 1 across the board. The bill before you is a modification of that, and it says that in those counties where only one hospital provides basic birthing services, a competing hospital can try to provide basic birthing services, and they will not be required to show a need to do so. They will, however, be required to meet all the other statutory review criteria. One of the review criteria that has been added looks to make sure that an applicant has the necessary staffing and ability to provide this care. That is not in current law. It will be added if this bill passes. And so that is an additional showing that we'll have to make, but they will not need to show need. The department has a rule pending approval that more or less does this exact same thing. Right now, it has not been approved by the board, but that is the perinatal services. The commission recommended maintaining CON regulation of inpatient psychiatric and substance abuse services, so that will stay in the as it is in the status quo. Also maintain CON regulation of skilled nursing facilities. So the nursing homes will need to come and get a CON. However, the bill incorporates Senate Bill 490, which allows a nursing home to split so long as they're in the same county. And the committee heard about this last year. It basically be, say you've got a nursing home in Cobb County with 100 beds. They will not currently be able to, and they want to offer, you know, 250-bed facilities. Currently, they need to go through a CON to do that, and they'll never be able to show need because they've got the 100 beds. And so what this allows is so long as the two split facilities stay in the county, they will not need a CON to split those facilities and have the same number of beds. They'll just be in two different facilities. That measure passed the Senate, and it is incorporated into this bill. The next piece is deregulating the continuing care retirement centers so long as the nursing beds remain sheltered. As the committee may recall, on this piece, we had consensus last year between the CCRCs and the nursing homes, and we more or less took that compromise that they agreed to, put it in the bill. It's been tweaked slightly, and it's passed the Senate, and it's Senate Bill 539, so that's been put in the bill as well. It's a fairly lengthy, you know, in the first year they've got 50% of the beds have to be filled and so on. It's got the page reference, but this is what this committee adopted last year based on a compromise between those two groups. Home health agencies will still be required to obtain a CON. That was a unanimous recommendation. Personal care homes will be deregulated except those that are Medicaid certified personal care homes. That passed the committee last year, and it's part in this too. And I, you know, several of these, and now that I'm thinking about it, Representative Carter, there was not in the group that met opposition to a lot of these. I mean, you know, the ones that you might expect where there will be a kind of the hospital physician issues or the hospital on hospital issues. The CON will remain for comprehensive inpatient physical rehabilitation. That's not a change either from the bill last year or the CON recommendation. And the traumatic brain injury facilities will be deregulated so long as there are detailed licensure standards, things addressing quality of care going forward. They won't need to show need, but there will be significant restrictions in terms of quality of care, but it will be done through licensing, not through the CON piece. That was in the bill that this committee passed last year as well. Now we're getting into ambulatory surgery centers. And rather than walking through the question asked three or four different ways, which is how the commission did it in 14.0 through 14.3, at least 3 through 14.3, if the committee would turn to page 6, it has listed out the proposal on ambulatory surgery. And we'll, I guess, start it and just walk down that list. Currently, as the committee is well aware, there's physician-owned, single-specialty ambulatory surgery centers, and they're the exempt facility. By rule at the department, physician-owned means the physicians have to own at least 85% of the facility. We're not changing anything in terms of physician-owned. That definition stays as it is in current law. But a physician-owned single-specialty ambulatory surgery center will have several changes. The first is the definition of single-specialty. Physiatrists are pain management doctors. They will be able to practice in an ambulatory surgery center so long as their services are reasonably related to the services provided by the surgeons in the office. So if you've got a physiatrist working in a oral surgery ambulatory surgery center and that physiatrist is working on pain control of the leg, that will not be allowed. It's not reasonably related to the service. Where we expect to see most of them, frankly, are in orthopedists and some of the neurosurgeons' ambulatory surgery centers because they do the pain management and the orthopedists do the surgery. In addition to that inclusion, general surgery will be expressly named as being included within the definition of single specialty. And also, there is a limited group of plastic surgeons that will have the opportunity to practice in an orthopedic ambulatory surgery center. And those plastic surgeons have to have what's called a certificate of added qualification in surgery of the hand from the American Board of Plastic Surgery. There's literally, no pun intended, only a handful of these folks in Georgia. And they are doing the same type surgery as the orthopedist, but this was a very limited definition that we were able to use and say that if they're doing the same procedure, they can be in the same facility. That's the change to the definition of single specialty, and that applies to the physician-owned and to the joint venture facilities going forward, and I'll get to the joint ventures in a second. Currently, the physician-owned ambulatory surgery centers have a capital expenditure threshold of about $1.8 million. The recommendation here is to raise it to $2.5 million. It is indexed to inflation as it currently is to the composite construction index. The physician-owned facility has another option. If they don't want to go the route of the capital expenditure threshold, they can go the route of capping their ORs. This committee last year passed out a bill that did not have capital expenditure thresholds, but instead said you're capped at, I believe it was 4 ORs, and there was an exemption for a 4 OR facility. This was one of the hottest debated, as you all might imagine, issues on any conversation about CON. The thought here is give the physician-owned single specialty center an option to build a 2 OR facility, not 4, not 3, but just 2. There'll be no capital expenditure threshold on that 2 OR facility. Now, the catch is there can only be one such facility per practice per county. So for those practices that only have one ambulatory surgery center, they may choose this option. For those that have 5 currently scattered about Metro Atlanta, they cannot put any new 2 OR capped facility in any county where they currently operate. And the thought is, if you don't put some type of geographic limit on the OR cap facilities, they could literally be in the same medical office building and have 12 ORs. And I think there was a consensus that that was not the route that wanted to go. If a facility takes advantage of the 2 OR cap, they cannot expand and get another operating room without first obtaining a certificate of need. I cannot tell you that there was consensus on how to count the ORs during the fall and winter discussions. There were proposals that put it up to 3 to be exempt, some to 4, some if it was a big practice they could have 4, if it was a small practice they could have 2. What we see is the folks taking advantage of these are not the larger practices but the smaller practices. The regulatory burden alone of just submitting a plan and saying, here's my 2 OR facility, and you don't have to get into capital expenditure thresholds and so on, that'll be an attractive option for some folks. For some larger practices, two ORs will not be sufficient, and they can operate under the current law. All physician-owned ambulatory surgery centers must make indigent, charity, and Medicaid commitments. This, too, we could not reach consensus during the fall and summer. As proposed, each facility has an option. They can either take Medicaid and Peach Care and then provide 2% of their adjusted gross revenue for indigent and charity care, which is defined in the bill. Or they cannot take Medicaid and Peach Care and provide 4% of adjusted gross revenue for indigent and charity care or uncompensated Medicaid and Peach Care. These are fixed numbers. As the committee passed out last year, it was up to 3% or up to 6%, and the department was going to figure out, based on their specialty and their region, which number applied. After having spent about a year debating that, there's a certain attractiveness to a fixed number, in that there's not the discretion, and there'll be uniformity across the board. There will be no credit for uncompensated care provided at the hospital. That was something that this committee had passed out, but that was also at the 3 and 6 range. The thought was if it drops to 2 and 4 and there's no credit for uncompensated care, 2 and 4 mean 2 and 4. And also, the ophthalmologists will be exempt from the indigent, charity, and Medicaid commitments. And the reason is this. Most of your ophthalmologist ambulatory surgery centers have patients that are either self-pay, they're getting LASIK, or they're covered by some form of Medicaid or mostly Medicare. And so it is very difficult for an ophthalmologist to have indigent charity patients. And so a fixed 2 and fixed 4% for them is almost, always going to be that because they can't meet it. And they'll have to pay the difference because that remains, just as the committee passed out last year. If a group has a 4% commitment and they only meet 2% of that, they'll have to pay that 2% difference to the department, and it goes to the indigent charity trust fund. Excuse me, indigent care trust fund. All the facilities will have to report data to the department, as was recommended last year. I can tell you all throughout the summer we had a host of things to try to address this 2 and 4, and give the credit for uncompensated care in the hospital. If a facility meets all reasonable efforts to try to meet the indigent charity and Medicaid commitments, that they could have that reduced. And the consensus of the group was keep it simple and keep it fixed. In addition to a physician-owned single specialty ambulatory surgery center, there can be a joint venture single specialty surgery center, which is what this committee passed out last year. The thought is we should try to incentivize hospitals and physicians working together on ambulatory surgery issues. So instead of having a $2.5 million threshold, the joint venture has a $5 million threshold for ambulatory surgery centers. And joint venture is going to be up for the two parties, and it's defined as a group of physicians in a single specialty, as we've now talked about, and a hospital. And so long as one of those parties owns at least 30%, they can define themselves within that guideline what joint venture means. Does it mean 50-50, 51-49, or whatnot? It's up to the market and to those parties to decide. The hospital can have a joint venture single specialty center only in the county where the hospital currently operates. So we're not going to have, cross-county fighting with joint ventures in the hospitals. It'll have to be where they are. The indigent charity and Medicaid requirements will be the same as applies at the hospital. So currently, take Medicaid and 3% indigent charity, and the joint venture facility will have to report data to the department as the physician-owned single specialty centers. If there's not any questions, I'll go on to how we treat the existing facilities that have a CON or have a letter of non-reviewability.
You mentioned, and this is the first time I've heard you mention it, the Indigent Care Trust Fund. And I know there was some concern about what's going to be happening with that with the hospitals in the near future. Can you kind of update us where we're at with that?
That is still in the hands of the folks in Washington. The moratorium is set to expire fairly soon, I think the hospital folks might have a better answer or feel for if and when that's going to expire. The thought, at least the last I heard, which was about a month and a half ago, is that currently CMS has a rule saying, you know, no indigent, or excuse me, intergovernmental transfers as we know them in Georgia, and Congress said don't enforce that yet, and my understanding is that was going to be extended. I'll defer to members of the hospital community. They would have a better idea on that than I would.
As Josh said, may I clarify this? Congress has said for them not to put the rule into effect. That is the prevailing thought in Congress?
Until May, the end of May of this year.
They said they could put it into effect
that's
after?
Correct. That's correct. It goes into effect on May 30th, unless there's an extension of the moratorium.
Okay. All right. Are there other questions at this point? No further questions. Okay, Josh.
The next piece talks about what happens to existing facilities that have an LNR. And as the committee may recall, last year I believe that House Bill 568 has passed, phased in the indigent charity and Medicaid commitments over a period of 4 or 5 years, depending on, you know, how you started calculating. What the bill before you does is provide that all of the facilities will begin reporting data on January 1, 2009. As we've discussed, every facility in existence needs to kind of pop their head up, let the department know where they are, what they're doing, etc. And existing facilities will not be required to make indigent charity and Medicaid commitments unless and until one of three things happen. They spend more than $800,000 over a period of 2 years for new equipment or for expansion. It's a capital expenditure threshold definition that applies. So if they, you know, refurbish an OR and they paint, clearly that's not getting in. But if they, you know, bring in a larger piece of equipment or bring in a new operating room, that in and of itself will bring the indigent charity Medicaid commitments to that facility. The second thing is building a new OR. That's a clear expansion, and then they'll be brought in under the indigent charity Medicaid commitment at that point. And the third is if they relocate pursuant to an exemption, which is that is another means by which they can be brought into the indigent charity and Medicaid facility. So the thought is a good deal of these facilities are going to want to expand at some point. And when they do, they'll be brought into the new rules just as the existing facilities. But for those facilities that have no desire to expand and will just continue operating as they currently do, they will not be brought into the indigent charity and Medicaid provisions. But by the same token, they won't be taking any advantage of the new law that is being passed.
Representative Peake.
Quick question then. So, and I have to jog my memory. If they applied for an LNR, they did have a commitment to do some indigent care?
No.
Okay. So, no. So if I'm an existing orthopedic center, amateur surgical center, and I decide not to upgrade my facilities, I will have no obligation whatsoever to provide any indigent care. Is that correct?
That's correct.
But you can't expand.
Right, right.
The enticement is to expand.
Right. But if they chose not to, they wouldn't be required to provide indigent care. Okay.
Right. Okay. The bill, and that's pretty much it for ambulatory surgery centers. The bill will maintain CON regulation of radiation therapy services. It will maintain existing CON regulation of PET. And we've already gone over the imaging, but here's the way it would work. The commission recommended unanimously to require exempt providers of diagnostic and therapeutic equipment to make commitments to indigent and charity care as a condition of the exemption. The way it would work going forward is if they spend $800,000 over a period of 2 years. So if they buy a machine that's $801,000, they're in. If they spend $300,000 on a machine 1 year and what, $700,000 the next, they're in. If they spend $300,000 and then $300,000 in 2 years, they're not. That's the way that it will work for the equipment and imaging. Statutorily exempt providers of diagnostic and therapeutic equipment will be required to provide data to the department. That passed out of this committee as well. The commission, the majority of the commission on a 514, recommended to modify the exemption for equipment below the threshold to require all freestanding diagnostic imaging centers to obtain a CON for equipment regardless of cost, except for those de minimis X-ray equipments. Physician offices and hospitals and other healthcare facilities would still be able to obtain equipment under the threshold, but freestanding centers would require a certificate of need. The bill before you adopts essentially that. It's the way we talked about it before. Physicians' offices and hospitals can take advantage of the exemption. Others cannot. The remaining items of the bill, and they're I tried to highlight ones that the committee will probably be familiar with. Obviously, the Destination Cancer Hospital, the Senate Bill 433, as it passed the Senate, has been incorporated into this bill. So a facility applying for a Destination Cancer Hospital will need to go through a CON process. There will be different review criteria than apply currently. And the thought behind that is because they're a different facility. They don't have patients from in-state. Some changes that have been added to Senate Bill 433 some of the bullet points, some I was just highlighting. One of the changes is that each corporate entity can only have one Destination Cancer Hospital. One of the things this bill does, as the bill that passed the committee last year, is expand the definition of person to include just about every corporate form we know of. And the bill says, you know, only one person can have a CON for a Destination Cancer Hospital. And the way that it works, and the language is a little different than that, but the way it works is each corporation only gets one. We're not saying there can only be one facility. There may be some constitutional problems with that, but, I mean, you know, CTCA will be limited to one Destination Cancer Hospital. It will have to be located within 50 miles of Hartsfield-Jackson International Airport, and the department, as the majority leader said, will not be accepting new applications after January 1, 2010. The thought was you give a facility a chance to apply. They have about 18 months, and then the door shuts, and there will be no more applications for Destination Cancer Hospitals. The hospital has to make a Medicaid and at least 3% charity indigent commitment. That was in SB 433 as passed. And there's a change, as the majority leader indicated, about the fine. If the facility, it is currently required to have 65% out of state. If it fails to meet that 65%, the first year it's $1 million, second consecutive year two, so on up to four. And then if, you know, in year three they were to meet the 65%, it resets and goes back to one. So it is a shall, there's no discretion. That is a fine, and you don't see that type of fine anywhere really in the code except on these Destination Cancer Hospitals. The bill also incorporates House Bill 967, which allows the Department of Corrections and the Department of Juvenile Justice the ability to treat inmates and youth in the custody of DJJ at an ambulatory surgical center inside prison gates or on the grounds of a DJJ facility. That has passed both chambers. It's in this bill as well. And last, the committee added to allow the department to have flexibility in cases where the governor has declared a state of emergency. Let's say there's a tornado and someone needs to go in and provide medical services. Technically, if it's a new clinical health service, they'll need to go through a CON process. This says they can be granted the authority to do that in the interim, and then they'll need to come back and do it later. And in short, members of the committee, that is the bill you have before you.
Josh, we have a question from Representative Houston.
On page 7, the Destination Cancer Hospital.
Yes.
Why did you leave Peach Care out?
I don't know that it is, actually.
On Cancer Treatment Center?
It may be in there.
On the paper we've given, it's Peach Care.
They don't see children.
Well. If it is left out, yeah, it's because they don't treat pediatric cancer.
Well, suppose another one, a Destination Hospital, applies before January 1 that some speech can.
They could.
Would it behoove us to put pitch care in there?
if they did apply,
Sir Michael,
and they did treat.
We're requiring the others to do peach care.
Representative Houston, would you speak? Get closer to your mic.
Thank you. We're requiring the others to do peach care. I mean, it's listed in the other physician on things. I just didn't understand why.
Well, they are required to see Medicaid, but because they don't see children, peach care is Medicaid. It's just that they do not see children. So,
all right, I just read peach care and the other. I didn't.
Right.
Representative Carter.
So is that to mean that we are to interpret it in both places as being Medicaid and peach care?
It's my understanding that they're required to see three and three, Medicaid and indigents.
No. My question is, if you're listing it over here as being Medicaid and peach care under 14.4 and then under additional items, I'm just looking for the consistency throughout the bill.
If an ambulatory surgery center, which is where you see the Medicaid and peach care language, doesn't treat children, there's no way they'll be able to sign up as a Medicaid provider. The same as here, it's just we know, for example, CTCA doesn't treat children. And so that's why the language is Medicaid versus an ambulatory surgery center that may. You could have a facility that treats children, and therefore they can take peach care and they can take Medicaid.
Okay.
They could meet their Medicaid requirement with peach care if they see children.
Okay. One thing that I'm just a little bit confused about, and the consistency through this is very important in my mind. 14.4, we've got 2% and 4%. Provide 4% of adjusted gross revenue for indigent and charity care, uncompensated Medicaid or peach care. And then when we get over to the destination cancer hospitals, we go to 3%. Was that some kind of compromise? Or
we had worked, all along when we were trying to build a case for CTCA, they agreed to see 3 and 3. So in working on the overall comprehensive plan, which dealt mainly with ambulatory surgical centers, we couldn't get agreement on 3 and 3. We could on 2 and 4, so that's why that applies there. But CTCA is willing to see 3 and 3, and that's they're a specific type of hospital and are fine with meeting that demand. CTCA is a hospital like other hospitals who see 3.
Right.
Ambulatory surgical centers are a different animal.
Josh, why wouldn't it be 4?
I think the thought was you treat CTCA like a hospital. And currently the rule in the department is that they see Medicaid in 3%. And so you provide that rule that applies currently to hospitals in Georgia to
okay.
CTCA.
Gotcha. Okay.
Okay. Questions? Okay. Who's got one? Oh, Representative Brenner.
I just want to make sure that I understand that if any other destination cancer hospital comes in to Georgia, they have to be within 50 miles of Hartsfield as well. And the moratorium is only open for 2 years.
The only opportunity to apply will be from July 1 of this year through through December 31st of 2009.
Representative Peak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Josh, I know last time we went through this scenario, there was a lot of angst about the freestanding imaging centers. Would you just simply walk us through again what the bill says regarding those? And
under current law, you can have a freestanding imaging center that's not owned by a physician, and they have an MRI that they got because it came under the $863,000 cap. We're still applying that cap, except we're raising it to $1 million and removing build-out costs, except the only parties that can take advantage of the cap without going through CON are physicians' offices and hospitals. the freestanding non-physician-owned centers will all need to go through CON. Physicians' offices will not. Hospitals will not.
Regardless of the cost, they would have to. They would be required to go through a CON process.
Anything other than basic X-ray, ultrasound, and there's the fluoroscopes and so on that are listed. Yes, they would.
Okay. All right.
Representative Houston.
I see where you put a limit January 1, 2010. What was your thinking about, you know, Georgia grew 1 million people in 1 year. Why are you limited to January 1? Why the limit? You know, you sort of think about laws being made to go on and on, not just to
Representative Houston, I, you know, it's not what I want to do. In fact, you know, if I could have my druthers, I'd just soon everybody do indigent work and Medicaid, and there would be no CON. But that's not where we are, and I'm trying to get a bill passed and trying to bring the hospitals on board, make them a little more comfortable, so having one short period of time where they could apply hopefully makes them a little more comfortable that CTCA is not going to take their business away from them.
Thank you.
Other questions from the committee?
Well, I don't think you can do that.
No other questions from the committee? Okay. We will probably meet tomorrow. I have to see if I can arrange for a room. We will take public comment, not a rehashing of the bill, very brief comments. I will let you know when the committee will meet and when I can get a room. Still no further questions? We are adjourned. Thank you, Senator, and thank you very much, Josh.